So everyone is very serious. That's great. So let's continue the seriousness. It's so cold here. I don't want to be taping so much, but I have to. It's just not warming up yet. So, but here we go. Very, very serious. I'm in a tremendous wow from this morning's practice already. And by going over everything very carefully, I can say the following, that I see a basic progression for success. And that is, the first step is recognizing continuity fear. This is the all-important first step. That's the pivotal point. From recognition of continuity fear comes the continuity fear practice. From the continuity fear practice, is I do not have a suffering problem. I have a continuity problem. I do not have a fear problem. I have a continuity fear problem. I do not have a world problem. I have a continuity problem. I do not have a sickness problem. I have a continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem there is. Therefore, the sickness problem does not exist. Only non-dual abidance resolves the continuity problem. Therefore, only non-dual abidance has value. Nothing else has value. This is the basic continuity for practice. I don't have a whatever dot 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 problem. I have a continuity problem. Continuity problem is the only problem there is. So this is the first practice, really, that is essential. What this practice does then leads us to the remedy. Once we see that our real problem is the continuity problem, there is no other problem, actually. This is the key turning point. Without this, all that we're going to do is we're going to try and take some position, whether it be the position of no position, which, you know, some clever ones arrive there, or some other position. That's not non-dual abidance. Once we see the only problem we have is a continuity fear problem, the remedy, we will realize that non-dual abidance is the only remedy there is, really, for the continuity fear problem. I need to be able to abide in that to reassure myself this is okay. It's not just a position, all right? It's the ultimate remedy for the continuity fear problem. So this becomes apparent. Once we do the continuity fear practice, it becomes apparent non-dual abidance is the remedy. Then we focus on the remedy. There is no other remedy. We tell ourselves this, there is no other remedy. And some of this has to be a little bit on faith. We see it, you know, we glimpse it, but we're not sure. So have faith in those who see it a little more clearly. We practice non-dual abidance. We practice that. So this is how it goes. We first the continuity fear. We recognize this is my real problem. This is the real problem. Without that, I wouldn't have any problems at all, because this is what is holding me to the false belief in fixation, and crystallization, and definition, and time and space, process, form. All this dream is the continuity fear that's holding me to this dream, but making me feel that I have no being without it. That I need to have this dream. Without this dream, I wouldn't be. So, and it's a it's a negative reinforcing loop, continuity fear, actually. Because the continuity fear says, no, I'm helping you keep what you need. Without this fear, you wouldn't keep what you need. And if you don't keep what you need, you'd be without what you need. Except the truth is, we don't have any needs. Okay. So without the continuity fear, we wouldn't have any problem whatsoever. None. Zero. So that's the only problem we have then. Once we get this, then we'll start practicing the continuity fear practice. And I'm looking at hindsight. This is what I've done. Then this leads to non-dual abidance, vision of oneness. We'll call it non-dual abidance for now. Non-dual abidance. And we start saying, hey, and you have a glimpse of it, and you start experiencing it, and you say, wow, but how can I abide in it, instead of just a glimpse? Then we get into non-dual abidance practice. This is where we are now. This is what I did this morning. This is called the neither-nor practice. This is the neither-nor practice. As much as possible, try to work the neither-nor practice into your day, and get more and more and more familiar with it. As I said before, there are those who have taken the position of no position. And that's not non-dual abidance. And they and that it threatens them. Say, oh, no, no, I gotta, you know, what do you mean neither nor? I can't do that. But that, the position of taking no position is the same as taking a position. It's a position of no position. That's just as stuck as anything else. So what I found is that those who don't recognize the continuity fear are trying to find the right position to take. So they take a spiritual position. They think, okay, I'm taking the spiritual position. And they want to grasp. They want to grasp it. They want to grasp this non-position, a spiritual position. And they come to a teacher, non-dual, not a teacher, a practicer. What we do here is we don't try to grasp anything. We practice non-dual abidance, which is neither grasping nor non-grasping. See, it's neither grasping nor is it non-grasping. See, grasping and non-grasping is still, that's duality. So we have to practice this. What we're doing here is not helping reach some ideological position, no matter how exalted it seems to be conceptually. We're practicing non-dual abidance. We're getting used to it. And what we experience, instead of an ideological position, we experience this wow. Okay, this is the difference. Now, it seems to the world that those who are working to grasp some exalted ideological position, they're making great progress, and those are the people, the pundits, the New Age pundits who go out in the world and write the books and tell people, you know, this and this, because they're talking about, yeah, you can reach this, you know, exalted ideological position. And so they seem, you know, popular and famous and successful and all this. And the ones that are just sitting here in the wow, nobody pays any attention to them at all. This is true. That's great. That's fine. This is the way. The wow is the way. The wow is the way. When you're in the wow, you don't have an ideological position. And we're getting used to that. Say, wait a minute, I'm either this nor am I not this. I'm neither grasping nor am I not grasping. It's just this wow, wow. So, this is the way that I advocate, is practicing in the wow, allowing the, instead of trying to grasp an ideological position. And, you know, that says it all. I mean, it says it all, really. And in the practicing is quite interesting and extraordinary, and it brings up this wow feeling, which is wow. I don't know what to make of this. I mean, I don't have a position on this. I neither have a position nor do I not have a position. and the reaction is wow. Instead of some ideological construct, it's just a wow. And this is what we have to practice if we want to succeed in getting free of our continuity fear. No other way works. No other way works. The other ways. Merely hold on to a need, even if the need is to see oneself as not having a need. Okay, that's still holding on to a need. And one can say, well, you're just being ideological. Well, the difference is we're talking about experiencing this. Wow, this is the center of it, the crux of it, and we actually practice that. So, of course, we're talking with those who have ideological fixations and concepts and who need help to realize they don't need any help, we have to use, say, something or silence or whatever we do. But it's pointing to practice. So we actually practice. We're not trying to grasp practice. We're not trying to grasp a non-practice. We're just actually practicing. And those who are ideologically fixated cannot understand this. They cannot accept it. The ego actually wants to know how to undo reality. So it's only interested in, it asks questions about reality, but it's just, okay, what is reality? Or what, only for the purpose of how to undo it. But there isn't any way to undo it. So the ego's never satisfied. It is never satisfied in its asking questions. The ego will ask questions. It's really trying to figure out, how do I change reality. That's its whole, and so it tells us, just fixate yourself on some high ideological position and let me do the rest. And it's trying to then figure out how to undo reality. But when we just full stop in the wow, the ego doesn't have anything to do. It says, what's your position? You know, I want to know what your position is so I can undo it. You know, take a position so I can undo it. If there's no position, the ego says, how can I undo it? And of course, the ego tells us that we need the ego, that it's an inherent need within us. This is a lie. This is a lie we're telling ourselves. Of course, the ego is just reflect as a mirror, reflecting our own lie back to us. So these practices are possible. We have done them. We are doing them. We will do them. We'll do them right now, if I can summon the will to do it. It's I call the need neither nor need practice. I neither have needs nor do I not have needs. I don't need needs nor do I not need needs. I don't need to have needs nor do I not need to have needs. So whatever exalted ideological position we have, practice putting into a neither nor format. However you do that, there are, you know, various ways. You your own mind, you have to work with your own mind and the peculiarities, temporary peculiarities, uniqueness of that. But I worked on this morning quite a bit, and it was wow. I neither have a position nor do I have a non-position. I neither have a position nor do I have a non-position. I neither have a position nor do I have a non-position. I'm neither grasping nor am I not grasping. I'm neither grasping nor am I not grasping. Okay, so take these fundamental spiritual tenets that we feel are so important and put them in, practice this neither nor format in this way. And of course, this dissolves ideological fixations, which results in what? Just wow, a feeling of wow. And then we are getting wise about the wow and not displacing it onto sex, drugs, rock and roll, etc., and all the allied complex of, oh, you know, this wow must be coming from this, or wow must be coming from that. No, the wow is coming from this practice of non-dual abidance. I'm neither have a position, nor do I have a non-position. I neither have a position, nor do I have a non-position. And so we experience this burn, this sort of this inner burn, this inner. You know, ideological fixations are dissolving. Continuity fear is evaporating. And so our imaginary fixations are sort of evaporating. We say, oh, I don't know what my position is. Well, wow. Full stop on the wow is our position. And we say, well, but that's you know, it's either a position or is it a non-position? Right. So we're practicing familiarity. What solves the continuity fear? Familiarity. What is continuity fear? Lack of familiarity with reality. That's all that it is. A lack of familiarity with reality. How do we resolve that? By gradually getting familiar with reality, allowing ourselves to, and even in just little bits like this, you know, it seems meager. It is meager, but Jesus tells us meager is enough. A little will is enough on our part, actually. We just do our little part. Holy Spirit does the rest. This is something we need to have faith in. You might say that faith in the Holy Spirit is the central tenet. Without faith in the grace of God, call it what you want, then we think we have to do it all. And say, well, so then we feel we need to take an ideological position to fixate on it, to say that we're doing a lot. Whereas if we have faith in the grace of God, that so we'll do our meager little part here. Full stop in the wow seems quite meager. Holy Spirit will do the rest. Grace of God will do the rest. So I guess you could say we have to have some faith in this. Otherwise, we'll try to do, you know, overreach. Say, well, this is not enough. How can this attain something? What? I don't need attainment, nor do I need non-attainment. I don't need attainment, nor do I need non-attainment. This is a great way to practice too. So, as you have all these spiritual concepts that arise, just use them for neither nor practice. This is my advice. I neither need attainment, nor do I need non-attainment. I neither need attainment, nor do I need non-attainment. Ultimately, we're going to realize that we don't have any needs at all. Okay, except the need to get familiar with the fact we don't have any needs at all. And this is a temporary, you might say it's a temporary need, which will be, we will forgive ourselves for that entirely and understand it's a continuity issue, a familiarity. So that doesn't mean it's an actual need of reality. Okay, but it is a pragmatic situation we're dealing with. So let those who want to have the ideological position of enlightenment, let them do that. I don't care. Don't worry about that. We're beyond that, actually. We're practicing non-dual abiding. It's actually practicing neither nor. I don't need attainment, nor do I need non-attainment. And this is not an ideological fixation we're trying to set up. We're allowing the wow of this practice to be felt and experienced. Now, it's a little uncomfortable. Absolutely it is. It feels like a workout, which is not bad. I love it. As I was running yesterday all over the place, I decided that, heck, I had a lot of bad news come up yesterday. And really heavy, severe, serious bad news. But I have this continuity practice. And I said, you know, this is better news. It trumps everything. Even if the whole universe is destroyed or in some catastrophe, I still would have this good news would trump it. Which is, I don't have any universal catastrophe problem. I have a continuity problem. Continuity problem is the only problem there is. There is no other problem. Other problems simply don't exist at all. Only non-dual abidance resolves the continuity problem. Therefore, only non-dual abidance has value. Nothing else has any value. So I was practicing this yesterday. I got up in the morning practicing this, and then the bad news came later in the day. And the whole constellation of bad news, really, I mean, it's just domino. You can see the whole thing. Wow. And I said, no, this trumps it. It trumps it. But I said, I want to just go out and play some golf. And I want to stay active. And it was late. It's late in the day. And it gets dark early. So they said, golf cart's in at 4:50. So I get to the back nine. It's really cold. It's getting dark. And it's 3 o'clock. 3 o'clock. And I say, wow. I said, okay, I'm going to go for it. I can do this. And I played the entire back nine in like 50 minutes, because I ran everywhere. Got on the tee, whack, ran, got on the cart, run to the ball, quit, run. Everything's running, clicking. No stopping, the whole thing. Now, eventually I ran into a foursome that slowed me down. But so I just said, okay, I can't. If there had not been a foursome for me, I would have finished the whole thing in 50 minutes, absolutely. I spent a bunch of time waiting for them. So I can do it in 50 minutes. I can play nine holes in 50 minutes. I can play an entire round in under 2 hours, actually. There's actually a sport called, speed golf or something, where people do this. It's so amazing. So we can go for it. You know, this is the attitude. I said, okay, it's getting dark. We got to get our cards in. This is very much a metaphor for the world right now. We're not foolish here. We're not denying that the nature of existence, what we call existence, all right, which is the imperilment, the attempt to change what we are. Historically, we're not denying the historical record. There's been catastrophe, severe catastrophe throughout the history of this planet. It's a fact. We're not denying any of this. And we can bet, you can bet your bottom dollar, it will continue to be that way. Because that's the purpose of this dream. Or of now, dreaming doesn't have to dream this dream. Dreaming can also dream a dream of non-imperilment, which we call the death-free realm. Okay, so dreaming has two options, either dreams of imperilment or dreams of non-imperilment. But you wouldn't dream of non-imperilment unless you first dreamed of imperilment. Because if you didn't first dream of imperilment, you would be completely aware of reality and you wouldn't need to dream of non-imperilment at all. So the second function of dreaming, a dream of non-imperilment, is only because of the first dream of impairment. That's the only reason. Okay, so it's not something in itself we would do, but it is pragmatically what we do. Okay, we dream of non-impairment. Holy Spirit dreams it for us. Our will is to accept this. Holy Spirit really is our spirit in the reassuredness. God reassured spirit that you will always be spirit. This dream has no effect upon you or upon me or reality whatsoever. Dream of impairment. And so it's like that. We don't have to pin it down. But so here I'm on the golf course is a metaphor for what's happening in the world. We have very short time to go. Very short time to go. And the video just clicked off and back on again. Interesting. Very short time. But we can do it. We can do it if we hurry up. And amazingly, I was able to do this. I was running up and down hills. I was even looking for golf balls down in gullies and arroyos and running back up. But when I got home, I could hardly drive home. And then I fell asleep. I slept so soundly. I woke up, opened my eyes. I was looking at the room. I didn't recognize the room. So where am I? Where is this? It took me quite some time before I recognized, oh, this is a room in my house. This is where I am. It really took a lot out of me. But physically, the body was jumping around and running and hopping and functioning. It was pretty amazing. I was like, wow. So this is a good sign. It's a very good sign. Not to say that you won't be tired, but today I feel fine. I feel good. I slept in. I feel good. So By July of 2016, there's going to be some fundamental pivot of this world where the attitudes taking a position, say this is the new position to take. Whereas, of course, non-dual, we're practicing non-dual abidance, which is neither taking a position nor taking a non-position. Okay. And this is all important. Only this resolves the continuity problem that we have. That's it. Only this resolves the continuity problem. Nothing else does. So the world is going to take a position that seems very important. Now, the precursor to this happens tomorrow, which is November 30th, which is beginning of climate change. It's the summit in Paris. Okay, United Nations Climate Change Summit in Paris. It starts November 30th, and they're going to come try to reach some sort of agreement. But more importantly than that, what's going to begin is the accountability and the data collecting to begin compiling accountability. This is the real important aspect of it, is global accountability of monitoring everything. So now we talk about, well, impairment, people say, oh, yeah, what are you talking about? Well, keep in mind that these climate change people and this Agenda 21, which is absolutely agreed upon from every government in the world. Every government in the world has signed on to this, which means the cabinets and the bureaucracy of every country in the world is all in on this. So this will trickle down to everyone. It will trickle down. And they say that we're completely imperiled here. Okay, so this isn't me saying this. This is the scientists. This is the NASA scientists running their computer models saying, we're doomed. It's too late. We're already doomed. Civilization is bound to collapse. Mass starvation. You know, this is what they're saying. We're doomed already. So the all the leaders of the world and the bureaucracies and the whole institution, they're all saying we are doomed. And I'm saying, hey, the purpose of existence is this impairment to try to produce a change in spirit, a new will, extra will to change the will of God, which created spirit. So right in front of our faces, we have this massive imperilment come being pronounced by religious leaders, scientific, technological, all these leaders are saying, hey, we are on the brink of extinction. They're the ones saying it. So I'm not necessarily saying that in terms of climate change. I don't know exactly. Nature has ways of balancing things. There could be other issues too, but so the history of this dream is in paramount. That's its purpose. It's not like we say, well, we had it, we had this dream, but something went wrong. Like the devil came in and caused impairment. That's nonsense. You know, that's absolute nonsense. Oh, we had this beautiful dream, such a nice dream, but Satan came in and changed it all and made it turn into impairment. That's a lie. That's a lie. The dream was a dream of impairment from the very beginning. As Jesus said, the ego is a liar, and a deceiver, and a murderer from the very beginning. This dream is a dream of imperilment from the very beginning. Nothing came in and altered it at all. In order to have imperilment, first you have to set something up that you view as valuable so that you can feel it's being imperiled. You can't have nothing and then have imperilment. Well, you say, well, nothing's being imperiled. What are you talking about? It's crazy. So, of course, it seems like we start out by building something up that has value. And then, son of a gun, here comes something, boom, you know, ruins it. And we say, ah, terrible. Where'd that come from? This setup is from the very beginning. This is the dream. We're intentionally trying to generate an extra will, some sort of will that God did not create us with, to enable us to have more will than God, so we can say that we're the prime creator. So the way we're doing this, the only way we can do this is somehow think that somehow something, you know, can be imperiled that motivates us. Oh my gosh, this is terrible. I've got to change. I've got to work on this. I got to learn. So we've seen past all this. You know, there's so many, many lies of the ego has come up and have caused us problems, and rebirth, because we're still struggling. I haven't got enough will yet. What's the matter with me? Or this dream is supposed to be, you know, let's make the world perfect. We had this beautiful dream of a world, but it's imperiled. How awful. Dreaming of a beautiful world, as I said, the dream is a dream of imperilment. That is only so that it can then be imperiled to produce the will. And so it is imperiled right now. Gee, who would have thought, right? Well, the wise ones know that from the very beginning. They know this and they pass it on to us. I heard it. I've seen it. I've looked at it. I agree. Now, the dream of non-imperilment is a dream of non-imperilment from the very beginning, also from the very beginning, but it's only in response to this dream of imperilment, and it's simultaneous. You say, it'll come up. It arose at the same time, co-existent, the two dreams, because God already knew that this dream of imperilment, we're free to try this. So God knew that if and when we would try it, that this dream of non-imperilment would also arise there. The Holy Spirit would have this dream of non-imperilment simultaneously. But this dream of non-imperilment is not a setup. Say, oh, this is a beautiful realm, but it's only being set up to be imperiled. No, of course not. That's the first dream. The first dream tries to set up something nice so that it can be imperiled to generate this extra will. So we've set up this beautiful civilization and so many people on the world and infrastructure and all this learning and everything. And now here we say, no, my gosh, you know, it's all imperiled. We're doomed. We're all going to starve to death and terrible, you know, stuff. And an asteroid, you know, may hit and just, you know, just, oh, how awful, how terrible. What caused this? What did we do wrong, God? And you get the Old Testament mindset, right? Of, oh God, we did so much good, and then somehow we did bad, and everything went wrong. And what did we do wrong? It's so terrible. We're so sorry. It's your beautiful dream. This is the Old Testament mindset. That's the first dream of imperilment. Of course, that's how the mentality acts. Like, gee, I don't know what's going on. One hand doesn't know what the other one's doing. God, what's the matter? God, what did I do wrong? Now, God is not fooled by that. That's why there's a New Testament. Jesus is telling us about this other dream, dream of the Holy Spirit, dream of non-imperilment. And there isn't this duality there of like, hey, I did something good, but some imperilment comes and destroys it. How awful. No, it's only non-imperilment. That's it. So non-imperilment also has to have something that's not imperiled, right? So that does still need a realm, all right, of appearancing. Because if there's just non-imperilment, there's nothing there, how can we have meaning say, well, there's non-imperilment. Well, what's not being imperiled? So, of course, non-imperilment also needs a realm so that it looks like nature. But we see nature, there's no imperilment taking place there at all. This is my testimony. I've seen it. I've experienced it. There's nothing, there's zero evidence of imperilment there. Going back, and you can see that everything's been there from the very beginning. Nothing has ever been imperiled there. So we have gotten to the essentials here. We really have gotten to them. We're not in ignorance anymore. We're not in ignorance. The ain't it awful thing is not fooling us anymore at all. Of course this world is in peril. That's the whole purpose of it. Of course there has to be something we value in order to feel imperilment, or believe in imperilment. In order to believe in it, we have to identify with fixation and crystallization. We have to. What I say is time, space, process, and form. We have to believe that's real. We need to, you know, so that's a need, or a need to believe in it. We have this need to believe. Of course, if we want to try and generate an extra will, we have a need to believe in imperilment, and something has to be imperiled, so we have to believe that there's some fixation and crystallization. In order to succeed, I need to believe. But we don't need to succeed at changing what we are. So we don't need to keep believing in fixation and crystallization for the purpose of impairment. However, since we're so used to that, we can still believe in fixation and crystallization in a realm of non-impairment, understanding that this is a pragmatic remedy, a familiarity thing. We can get used to non-impairment that way. We're not deluded. You hear about people going to these paradise realms, etc. Well, yeah, but they understand why. Why is it? Why is this? Why are we doing this? Most go there after the body dies here in this world. They go. Those who were sufficiently wise then can abide in these so-called, you know, that's high realm, non-death realm. But perhaps now we don't even need to die to do this. This is what we've been told, that somehow our bodies will be changed into light bodies or something like that, and we will be able to shift into this realm. This is a possibility. This is what the scriptures tell us. So I'm not ruling that out at all. I don't think we should rule that out at all. We're not making this an exclusive, like this has to be it, because we can certainly practice non-dual abidance right here, right now, and we can abide in non-dual abidance right here, right now, and see the inherently non-fixated, non-crystallized nature of everything by realizing we don't need to change what we are. When that we don't need to change what we are, then we don't need to believe in fixation, because only by believing in crystallization of appearancing of light can we believe in impairment. It's the only way. Otherwise, we see, you know, it's just light. It's not fixated. It's not imperiled in the slightest bit. So we keep believing in there's these things instead of just the play of light, unfixated light, unfixated spaciousness. So we have kind of both of these issues on our plate right now, and they're not mutually exclusive at all. And it's interesting. It'd be interesting to find out how this works out. It's sort of an extra thing. Most the Christian tradition does have this end times rapture and end times, the saints will be, their bodies will be turned into light bodies, and they'll go into the paradise, the heavenly realm, the death free realm. This is what we're told is going to happen, and it wouldn't surprise me if this happens because of the imperilment that could be coming upon this world. We're told it's going to be the worst ever here. This is what this. Bible at least says. And, you know, maybe they're right. Maybe that is right. Possible. It's possible. So for those who say, well, I'm not quite ready to, well, we probably could, at this point, abide in this death-free realm. I'm feeling more comfortable with it, more comfortable. As far as non-dual abidance here in this realm, this is a high goal. And Jesus tells us it's a high goal here. It's, you know, he says many, you know, not many will actually do that while they're here. Well, I can understand that. Like Ramana Maharshi absolutely did that. There haven't been a lot like him recently who actually abiding in non-dual abidance, just non-dual abidance, that's it. But I can see how certainly is possible, absolutely is possible, given the right cultural situation, the right situation, etc., where that there's an allowance for that, and even, you know, even not, it's theoretically is possible, sure we can. I mean, I don't say we can't, I might do it, sure, why not? If it doesn't happen, it doesn't happen. But the death-free realm is available to us. I have gotten an invitation there. Not only have I seen it, but I've gotten an invitation from Jesus saying, would you like to come visit my place? I said, yes. And I said, where is it? He says, real close. Oh, it's right there. It's just like a fence is there, and then the other side of the fence, it's there, right there. So we should not despair. We have at least two options that will work for us. Non-dual abidance is the ultimate, you would say, is the ultimate. But I would say that non-dual abidance would come rather quickly in the death-free realm, from abiding, living in the death-free realm. And it would be very easy for non-dual abidance to arise there, to abide in it. Yeah. But we'll keep trying to do it while we're here. Absolutely. This is, my goal is to, you know, do this right here in this right now. Absolutely. And we're working on it and we're practicing it. So don't just sit back and wait for one option. You know, get ready for both options. That's right. Because again, the purpose of this dream is imperilment. And just when you think everything's nice, that's when the imperilment tends to strike. I've experienced this over and over and over and over and over again in this world. As soon as we get a setup, worldly setup in this dream of thinking, ah, this is how I want it. As soon as that clicks in, then imperilment strikes. It's a setup. It's all a setup. This is how the dream is. But that does not mean that non-dual abidance is a setup. It does not mean that. Or the death-free realm is a setup. No. Because clearly we've pointed this out here in this video. That it's the practical remedy of familiarity to this first usage of dreaming. Dreaming can have two usages. All right. So we're using the second usage, which is to free ourselves from the first usage. Absolutely. This is what Jesus points out. This is part of his mission here, is to point, make these, you know, points with, to us, point it out, this and this. There's these two ways you can use dreaming, and the second way is to free us from the first way. He can say illusions, mirages, dreaming, wishful thinking. The second one frees us from the first one. So, non-dual abidance doesn't mean that suddenly we will be imperiled. It does not mean that at all. It means that we will not be imperiled. We've given up the dream of imperilment for a dream of non-imperilment. But yeah, I bet you we've all experienced this, that we say, okay, everything's just right, I've set everything up right, and then suddenly something in our mind says, uh-oh. I feel something wrong. I'm a little nervous. And then, son of a gun, if troubles then don't arise to, you know, tear down the beautiful, the perfect situation you think you've made. And we keep thinking, why does this keep happening? God, what's wrong with me? If I pray to you more, will you prevent this? Of course not. if we have to free ourselves from the familiarity with this first usage of dreaming by having a second dreaming that helps us get familiar with reality, where there's no dreaming at all. Neither a dream of imperilment nor a dream of non-imperilment. I don't need a dream of imperilment, nor do I need a dream of non-imperilment. There's no need for that in reality. So practicing is not an ideological position, and this is so important. If you get this, those who get this will succeed. Those who don't get this will not succeed. They'll get stuck. They'll say, wait a minute. You just said this, and now you're practicing, and it's not an attempt to reach an ideological position. It's allowing ourselves to experience the wow of no ideological position. Reality doesn't have an ideological position on reality. This is very important to hear this. It doesn't have any ideological position whatsoever. None. Zero. Reality doesn't say, I am real. It does not. It's silent. Which is why Rama Maharshi was silent. He was conveying familiarity with reality to us. To those wise enough to get clued into this. So, go time. 50 minutes to play 9 holes of golf. I mean, 9 into 50 is 5, about 5.5. So 5.5 minutes a hole. I have to average 5.5 minutes a hole. Gotta run. It was fabulous. I loved it. Played pretty well too, actually. The less you think about it, the more better you play, it seems like. I gotta play it faster too. I fooled around a little bit here and there. But yeah, it's doable. It is doable. Whatever we have to do, we can do it. And the experience is the wow, not an ideological position. Now, the problem is imperilment. We tend to, that drives us into ideological fixation. And I believe that this is what's going to happen starting tomorrow with the climate summit. It's this final phase of being driven into an ideological position. And non-dual practice is to practice not having an ideological position. Okay, it's to practice not having an ideological position, to practice it. We're not taking an ideological position of not having an ideological position. We're practicing not having an ideological position. How does it feel? How does it feel? How does it feel? Not thinking, how does it feel? And not sensation, but how does it feel? And not emotion, but how does it feel? How does no ideological position feel? And initially, it will feel like this, wow. Because you say, well, I'm not familiar with this. And it is a burn of not having ideological position. It's kind of, it burns us. We feel I call it the burn. I'm experiencing it right now. It's pretty much like for example, working out and you feel this burn and you realize, wow, I'm really, you know, stressing the muscles. I'm really putting myself through the cardio work here. Wow, I'm feeling the burn. But you say, that's good. That's good because, yeah, it's a little suffering right now. But tomorrow and the next day, You know, I'll be walking along and suddenly I feel be bouncing on my toes. I say, wow, I feel so much more nimble now. So it is putting up with this intentional mild discomfort, you might say, knowing that this will have great benefits for us. Not trying to grasp benefits. Benefits will arise. They don't need to be grasped. Reality is doesn't need to be grasped. It's already present. So there's sort of just this arising, it just a dawning, just a dawning. It will dawn. What dawns for me is these better practices, more effective practices. So thank you. This is what's needed. We need to actually practice instead of get some sort of ideological fixation, however exalted we tell ourselves it will be. The ego tells us that just the ego is just a mirror. We're telling ourselves this. We can say, I neither have needs nor do I not have needs. I neither have attainment nor do I have non-attainment. Neither attainment nor non-attainment. And if we want to be clever about it, we don't need to. We could, well, it's neither attainment nor non-attainment, nor is it not attainment nor attainment. But there's no need to be that clever. We're only going for the wow. Those with ideological fixations tend to try to get clever, too clever, to sort of, again, the ego is saying, how do we undo it? So it's looking for a way in this regression, this infinite, regression or whatever, infinite extrapolation. It can go on and on and on of maybe this is a way to undo reality. So we don't really let, humor the ego too much about this. It's just simple neither nor practice is enough. And the burn is there. Yeah, similar to like a not eating breakfast. Or some, and you feel like hungry, I feel hungry. Well, we're feeling this hunger for an ideological position. It's like, why? Familiarity. And if we're practicing, we don't let it go any further than just the burn and the wow. We don't allow ourselves to start thinking, well, what kind of ideological position can I get to stop the burn? We don't think that way. We refuse to allow that sort of thought process to arise. We squelch it. We're not trying to arrive at a position. Neither arriving nor non-arriving. Neither arriving nor non-arriving. Neither arriving nor non-arriving. Certainly, you will know very well when you feel this, that it's you're not taking an ideological position and you're feeling the jitters and the burn about this. You will certainly be aware of it, and that's great. And you know you're practicing successfully, and this is the only remedy there is, actually, the only remedy there is, because we only have one problem, and this is the only remedy for that one problem we have. And the ego will say, well, you're not doing anything. I mean, you're not taking any position, meaning you're not taking a position that can be then destroyed, that can be imperiled. So the ego is all about imperilment. So the ego says, you have to take a position. How else can you feel and believe in imperilment? If you don't take a position, how can you be imperiled? And if you can't be imperiled, how can you change what you are? If you can't change what you are, you're going to be frustrated. And I say, no, because we don't have a need to change what we are. We imagined we had this need. God did not create us with this need, so we will not feel frustrated. The ego is mistaken, and we're mistaken in saying this. That's the fundamental mistake, that somehow we won't feel right unless we change what we are. And as long as we believe that, we will take a position, whatever it is, so that this position can be imperiled. So the truth of all this is hitting home, hitting hard, which is great. It's like a workout. This is like going fast. We need to go fast now. Climate change talks start tomorrow. Not just talks. This is final agreement. I haven't been following it. I'm just aware it will start tomorrow. And this is go time now. It's absolutely go time. December, January, February, March, April, May, and June. That's 7 months. And then the first accountability meeting is in July 11th or something like that. It's the first meeting where the metrics will begin to be evaluated on how are we doing to meet the Agenda 21, 17 Sustainable Development Goals. And climate change is one of all of that. This is the first metrics meeting that will be the beginning of this trickle down monitoring of everyone. It's coming. It's in the pipeline. But more than that is in the pipeline. Most the Holy Spirit keeps telling me more than that is in the pipeline. Well, I just have to go on faith that this is so. So we just have to ask the Holy Spirit to remove everything in our lives that interferes with this accelerated effort that we have. Because obviously our lives are geared in such a way as to go slowly. Most right, slow down, don't go too fast. I mean, it's like, say, play 9 holes in 50 minutes. Come on, I'm not going to enjoy that. What is that? Well, it was fun. It was a blast. I loved it. I hit the ball really well. It was different. It wasn't this leisurely thing, but it was fun. It was fun. It was something different. So we just ask the Holy Spirit to remove everything in our lives that doesn't have to do with this accelerated go for it effort. Now the vacation that I had, workcation, is looking back is extraordinary. How much I got accomplished is just almost unbelievable, really. All the videos, all the taping. I did all that taping in 4 days. 4 days. Or maybe less than that. 3 days, actually. Well, 3.5, we'll call it. Plus all this other stuff. Did just amazing. And I was able to produce all the videos, get them up. Most people aren't watching them. I don't know why, but they're not. That's okay. But I did all that. It just shows we can accomplish a tremendous amount in a very short period of time if we decide that's what we're going to do. That's what we have to do. And if we do have to do that, if we want to avoid this ideological fixation, which the world is working on. Most of the world, 99.999999% of the world, is working on coming to some agreement about some ideological fixation, working on what do we need to fixate on. And they intend for everybody to fixate on it. Agenda 21, the language in there is unmistakably repeated over and over and over. Nobody left behind, everyone in the world. No one, not one single one of us left behind on this agenda. We will all fixate. So they're not joking about that. And the money that will pour into tech companies is so astronomical that you know, they're all in on it. They're all in. It's the new economy. Monitoring, fixation, ideological fixation is the new economy. And this new economy is going to come on like gangbusters. And there may be something else come on like gangbusters as well. Imperilment. Yeah. Not a surprise at all, really. So how do we go for it? How do we go? This is my prayer. This is my prayer. The first hole I played, I just gripped it and ripped it and hit this perfect drive, extremely long perfect drive, and then just hit a 9-iron, beautiful, onto the middle of the green, easy two-putt, boom, off the next hole. The next hole didn't go so well, hit into a bunker, and it was a wet and hard pack, and hit a shot over the green, and then hit a great chip back, and then two-putt. But, it, you know, I just kept going. Whatever, going to bunker, you know, play, go. No stopping, no bemoaning. Just say, okay, hit it. Run to the next one. Oh, I hit it way over there, and I had sprinted over there, and hit again, sprinted back. It was, you know, sprinting, really. Sprinting up hills, sprinting down hills. Lots of fun. We have the continuity fear practice. We have the neither nor practice. The two essential practices, we have them. We know what they are. It's like having a swing. I found this new swing yesterday and it worked. I said, I had this swing, so it was easy. I got this swing, I know it's going to work. We have these practices, we know they're going to work. This is in hindsight, looking back. I say, these practices work. These are super effective practices. Continuity fear practice and the neither nor practice. I neither have attainment nor do I have non-attainment. I neither have attainment nor do I have non-attainment. I have neither arrived nor have I not arrived. I have neither arrived nor have I not arrived. I have neither accomplished nor have I not accomplished. I neither have needs nor do I have non-needs. I neither have needs nor do I have non-needs. I neither have needs nor do I have non-needs. Well, we have the full stop in the wow practice. This is the ultimate overall practice, is full stop in the wow practice, because these continuity fear practice and neither nor practice bring up the wow. They bring up the wow. And then we do not try to find an ideological position to get rid of this wow and the burn of not having an ideological position. We just allow that to just gradually mellow out, which it does. Nor do we try to displace the wow feeling, the burn feeling, no ideological position, wow, onto something else that would generate some parallel, something vaguely similar, some thrill, some drug experience, whatever, music. Oh, I'm feeling so wowish about listening to this music. We don't displace it onto those any of that. We don't displace it. Say no, it's coming right directly from this practice. And that's all we need. We'll just let it mellow out here. Let it dissipate. And this wow is like a sprint. It's like a sprint. We're going really fast. I neither have an ideological position, nor do I have a non-ideological position. I'm neither grasping nor am I not grasping. I'm neither grasping nor am I not grasping. This is a good one. I'm neither grasping nor am I not grasping. And we don't allow the ideologues to take this situation over because we're practicing the wow here. And again, the ideologues are really driven by the ego, which is to set up a position which can be then imperiled. That's what the whole purpose of this existence, as we are seeing, experience this dream of existence, you might say. That's the whole purpose of it. And again, dreaming can be given a second purpose, which is a dream of non-imperilment. Absolutely it can. Jesus emphasizes this. It can be given, and the Holy Spirit has given it a second purpose for dreaming. Dream of non-imperilment. So that's why the videos, beautiful videos I produce of nature's dream of non-imperilment. Maybe those are not helpful or not, I don't know. Well, hindsight will show. I did have a dream last night where I made a mistake, and I recognized it and said, huh. So we'll see in hindsight. Hindsight will help us out. But we have to be very careful that we're not taking some ideological position of not having an ideological position. This is failure. And this is what the true teachers point out to us, that this is the obvious trap. It's not a subtle trap, it's obvious. Again, it bears repeating over and over, reality does not have a position on reality. None. And so the ego, and we're a non-dual bias, the ego says, well, what's your position on, what's reality's position on reality? Well, there isn't any. And the ego says, well, it's no good, no use then. Well, it doesn't need to be useful. Reality doesn't need to be useful. What does it need to be useful for? The ego is meaning it's not useful, meaning how can it be imperiled if there's no position? I don't see any way I can be useful. The ego says, I can't be useful. Well, we don't have a need for the ego to be useful, because we don't have a need to change what we are, try to change what we are. So seeing this is a wow, is a burden. I'm just looking at this, mentally looking at it, just wow. And then you realize you're a rising star. You in non-dual practicing. The realization hits, it hit me, yes, like wow. No wonder why these teachers are taking interest in me, that these teachers, famous teachers that we know about, have, you know, contacted me and have taken interest in me, because I'm a rising star in practicing, non-dual practicing, which is the only way there is, not in some ideological fixation. So of course they're looking for rising stars. They're looking at you too. Looking at all of us. You know, who are the rising stars? Let's you know, we need more and more and more and more help in this way. Help to realize we don't need help. Help to accept we don't need help. Reality doesn't need help. It's not like there's some need for reality to change what it is, so it needs help in that. This is a whim that we have imagined. Reality doesn't need any help to be changed. It doesn't need to be changed. There's no need. Reality doesn't have any needs. And the ego says, but that's not helpful. Well, it doesn't need to be helpful. Reality doesn't need to be helpful. To what? To the ego? To the an imaginary need to change what it is? There's no such need in reality. So all this is hitting hard. It's like running. It's like playing golf at a running pace. Of course, those speed golfers don't even use a cart. They run the whole thing. That's good exercise. Gazelles. Some people are like gazelles. Okay, perfect example right there. Someone lost their cell phone. Imperilment. I can't function. But like, you know, but more than that, you know, it's just severe imperilment. So we think, oh, we have these technological devices. Isn't it great? Oh, but I lost it. Oh my gosh, I can't function anymore. This is hideous. I can't call anyone. I have emergencies. I'm, you know, I might, but, you know, in the case of some people, they're getting older, you need to call people and just, you know, help or something. Help, I need help, I need help, I need help. No cell phone, can't do it. Imperilment. There you go. Perfect example. We're so dependent on technology now for living that if something were to happen to that, unbelievable impairment, right? Of a coronal mass ejection, knocked a severe one, high X class, knocked out satellites. How would the world function, actually? The economy, banking, you know, how would it could knock out electronics in this on this planet? Nobody would be able to function except peasants, you know. It's they would have any trouble. They'd keep growing the corn, going to the well. Maybe that's they say the meek shall inherit this earth. Of course, it's all a dream. Who wants to inherit a dream of imperilment? So, the world just doesn't get it at all. They just don't get it. And as far as people getting serious about this and actually practicing, most always say, well, not yet. I need to get a better ideological position, fixation first. Of course, the whole practice is to practice getting used to no ideological fixation, no position. So to say, well, I don't have a good enough position yet to practice no position, that's the ego saying, well, you know, in order to succeed, I have to have a really good position in order to imperil it, right? That's the ego's idea of success. The ego says, how can I succeed if I don't have a really, really good ideological position to destroy? That's the only way I can get this extra will to change what I am, and I need to change what I am because I have this need to do so. If I don't do so, I won't fulfill the need that God gave me, and therefore God will just annihilate me and throw me into this lake of fire for I'll burn forever, and this kind of stuff. The Bible was not written by Jesus. It was, you know, it came down, a lot of collaboration, a lot of stuff happened, and so should we include this or not include this, and what version of this, but a lot of stuff in the Bible Jesus didn't say. He didn't say, if you don't do this, you'll be thrown into a lake of fire, and your souls will be annihilated, you'll burn forever. Nonsense. It's just continue on with imperilment until you decide to get familiar with non-imperilment. Any position we take is for the purpose of imperilment, except the dream of non-imperilment. We can have a dream of non-imperilment, absolutely. But that is only, again, a remedy for the first dream, for the dream of imperilment. It's not a purpose in itself. As we pointed out earlier, reality doesn't have any need to dream of reality. Or to dream of non-imperilment. It has no need to dream of non-imperilment. So we wouldn't do that unless first we had a dream of imperilment. And, you know, we're aware of this. This is obvious to us, obvious to reality. This is all understood, all accepted. It's not a problem. And I'm having just massive imperilment around me. People, they're going into imperilment shock. I mean, their lives are becoming imperiled, severely imperiled right now. Just about everybody around me. Whereas I'm feeling better and better and better, actually. Give me a little water and a protein smoothie, and that's it. That's all what else I need. Have these practices, so we can practice those. So we practice these. Why should we despair? Why are we in despair? We're going, at the very least, to the death-free realm. All right. And even beyond that, we're going to non-dual abidance. Absolutely. Reality does not have a position on reality. So there's no position to be imperiled. No way. No, there's nothing to tear down. And that's why the ego says, well, there's nothing there. The ego looks at reality and says, there's nothing there. Meaning, there's no functionality for the ego there. Nothing to be imperiled. There's no way to imperil reality. So the ego says, well, there's no opportunity, no functioning, nothing there. I can't function there. But we don't need the ego. We don't need to try and change what we are. It's not a need. We don't have needs. Reality doesn't have needs. And we cling to the need, belief in need. Why? Continuity fear. That's why. So we may keep thinking, well, there's a need, but it's only because of continuity fear. The more we evaporate the continuity fear by practicing familiarity with no position at all, the less this becomes problematic to us. We just kind of say, ah, yeah, well, it's not a big deal. I'm not worried about it anymore. We can't ideologically get rid of ideology. Cannot do that. This is the mistake that many make. And Jesus says, we can't make illusions real and get rid of it. We cannot take a position, ideological position, to get rid of an ideological position. Not really. We have to actually practice this neither nor, which is, I'm both taking an ideological position and not taking one. In other words, you don't get fixated. Practice non-fixation. But of course, we have to do that in a seemingly conceptual way. I'm neither attaining nor not attaining. There's neither. That I don't have the position of attainment, nor do I have the position of non-attainment. There's no position of attainment. There's no position of non-attainment. There's no abidance in attainment. There's no abidance in non-attainment. There's no abidance in success. There's no abidance in non-success. So the world is, what's the attitude? Imperilment. So I went to this place where there was no attitude of imperilment at all, hardly. Wise thing to do. Because the world is saying, we must fixate. We don't want to lose the fixation. We have to. That's the ego saying, I must have a function. I must keep functioning. If I don't keep functioning, I'll be thrown into non-dual abidance, no position, and I won't have any functionality, and I will, God will annihilate me. This is what the ego is saying. So the world is frantic to find a stronger fixation so that the ego can imperil that. Because once this imperilment, cycle of imperilment, that we're gonna, you know, they're going to need another one. They say, well, where do we go from here? Okay, we see the imperilment coming, but how do we build something up that's better that can be torn down too? You know, how do we succeed at this? And they're very concerned about this. We cure this sickness, but where do we get a better, you know, more worse sickness? how do we come up with that? How do we build up our health so then we can imperil it again? And we have to reward ourselves a little bit in this dream. So we say, okay, we had this terrible imperilment, it was awful, but now things are a little bit better. And then we have to build up, you know, some positivity again in the dream so they can be torn down again. That's all that it is. We're just looping around. Build up some positivity and it gets torn down. Build it up, torn down. Build it up, torn down. Build it up, torn down. That's it. This is the dream that we believe is necessary. This is the dream we believe is necessary for us. So what a terrible... It's not necessary. Reality doesn't have any necessity to it. Because there's nothing else. There's no position of necessity. I'm neither abiding in position of necessity, nor am I abiding in a position of non-necessity. I'm neither abiding in a position of truth, nor am I abiding in a position of not truth. I'm neither abiding in any position, nor am I abiding in no position. I'm neither abiding in a position, nor am I abiding in no position. So those who are going along with the world, which is almost everyone, they will continue to make things very problematic for everyone, for themselves and for everyone else. Those of us who are going to this other dream, going to non-dual abidance and death-free realm, probably, you know, both of those, I would say, how do we use our time? How do we function, you know, during this next 7 months or so? Because certainly people around me, I'm dying, I'm losing this, I'm losing that, I'm functioning, my functioning is falling apart, you know, this is what I get constantly. But for me, it's just the opposite. I'm getting better and better and better and better. I feel feeling better and better and better and better. More and more and more confirmed in practicing. Confirmed in familiarity, practicing familiarity, practicing familiarity. The practice is not to take an exalted ideological position, is to practice familiarity with non-dual abidance, which is neither a position nor a non-position. See, reality is not saying, oh, I don't have any position. No, in other words, taking a position of not having a position. No, it just is. Jesus says the best way I can just say it just is, but even that doesn't convey it. It can't be conveyed, it can only be experienced. It cannot be conveyed, it can only accurately convey, it can only be experienced. But we can practice familiarity through the neither nor. We can practice familiarity with the loosening of any fixation, crystallization, process, time, space, process, form, crystallization, fixation, traces, residue, all this. We can practice not experiencing this. We don't need it. Practicing this feeling like, I don't really have any fixation. I don't. It's not this. It's not this. It's not this. And it's also not this. Neither this nor 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 not this. And the people are crying, help, 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 or trap, or trap, trap. Now I'm seeing that what they're really saying is, what do we do after this imperilment? You know, how do we build up positivity again? And so they want help in that. That's not what the true teachers are about at all. They're not here to build up positivity in something. They're here to help us practice familiarity with letting go of fixation. Letting go of both fixation and non-fixation. Because non-fixation also is a fixation. Reality is neither fixated on fixation nor non-fixation. It just is. There isn't anything other than that. There's no need to try and change what it is. So in this practice, the whole point of it is just to get this burn and the wow, not to reach some ideological position. So it's just a workout. Oh, this is a workout. And we come away from it saying, wow, that really hit hard. That's great. But maybe say, well, what's my position? What's my new position? I don't have, I don't, I'm getting used to not needing, feeling I don't need one. Because there's only an imaginary need. It's not a real need at all. But we're so familiar with belief in needing a position, needing something to be torn that can, so it can be torn down, that it takes work here. We need to work at this, a familiarity. Practice it. Now, once we do a practice, then it uses up a lot of our effort and energy and willingness and all that. And so try not to go back and say, okay, no, wait a minute, let me do it again. No. It's like if we take a hike, we don't say, okay, did I really take the hike? Let me go back and do it again. Of course, that'll wear us down too much. And so it's ridiculous. We don't say, okay, let's do it again right away. Because then we're really denying that we did it in the first place. This is the ego. The ego saying, I'm not sure you did anything there. I don't see the ideological shift. Did you really do? Did you really reach a new ideological position? I don't think you did. Better do it again. No, we practiced familiarity with non-dual abidance, neither having a position nor having a non-position. So we let it sink in now. I don't know what to do next, honestly. I've done all the video editing there is. I don't have more video really to edit. So I'm doing this now, and what's next? This is big time right now. Climate change starts tomorrow. We need a big push here. Need a big push. I'm all for it. Now, coming away from this practice, the ego will say, "Well, you didn't do anything." I mean, I don't think it was. Maybe you tried, but it wasn't successful because it's looking for what it can tear down. Where's there some crystallization to tear down? And it says, "Ah, I don't really sense it. So you're not doing very well." So the ego will say, "You're failing. You're failing." And its eyes, you're a failure because you're not giving it an opportunity to function. So that's what it wants from you. From us, that's what it wants, and so I'm just not seeing it. You're failing, you're failing, you're failing, and we say no, we're practicing, getting familiar with non-dual abidance is what we're doing. So thank the ego. We're failing. Oh, thank you. That's great. I certainly want to fail to give you anything to tear down. And I can feel trying to displace it onto music. This is what I often do. Or sports. A song will start popping up in my head and start going over and looping over and over. Say, this is a position. You know, oh, okay, because my history is composing music, so the idea of effort would be to come up with some song. So the ego's saying, well, you know, you didn't succeed at all. Let me help you. Here's a song for you. You know, maybe think about this as being successful. You know, this is what you need to fixate on. Is maybe you can compose a song as nice as this one. So the ego will give me a song to try and motivate me, saying, well, you kind of failed in that practice. You didn't really get anywhere, but here's a song that'll help you. So that's the ego saying, let me help you out. Let me help you out. Terrible, isn't it? Absolutely. And again, I use the term sex, drugs, rock and roll. The ego said, let me help you out. Let me give you this. You need some help. Obviously, you need some help. You failed to come up with a better position. Terrible. Real failure of a practice there. Let me find a teacher for you. I got to find a better teacher for you. Someone can help you out and get a better idea about what it's like to not to have a non-position. Better idea, ideology, concept of a non-position, or a concept of non-duality. Don't need that. We don't have any such need. There is no such need. It's not that we overcame a need. We're not overcoming any need. There's no need. We imagined it. To try and be greater than God. Try to be our own, the creators of ourselves, of our own will. To be the ones that gave us our the will that we have. We wanted to be, say that we gave ourselves that will, not God, not the prime creator. So all I can do is just pray that everything be removed that stands in our way. That's pretty much all I can say. Because a lot could stand in our way. You know, if we ask it to, the world's set up to stand in our way. It really is. It's set up to stand in everyone's way. We don't want that. We don't need it. We don't have needs. Reality doesn't have needs. We are reality. Reality doesn't have needs. I am reality, and reality doesn't have any needs, including doesn't have a need to not have needs. And neither has a need to have needs, nor a need to not have needs. It just simply is. As Jesus said, it just is. And there's no need to take a position on isness. That's the ego. The ego says, I have this need. The ego is just a mental projection. It's not a self. It's not a self. There's no need. We're just projecting the belief in need. So what is going for it right now? What does that mean for us? This is what has to be discovered and done. If we can't struggle with it too much, then it really wears us out. On the other hand, we have to pick up the pace somehow. We've already been going at a fast pace, but it seems like we have to pick the pace up now. So the climate agreement situation starting now. This means we have to pick up the pace of this practice. We will see how that happens. It neither has to happen nor does it need to not happen. Neither needs to happen nor does it need to not happen. Neither needs to happen nor does it need to not happen. Okay, very great. That's enough. Very intense. And we will.